In this video, I'm going to talk about light and conservation of objects in shops, museums and art galleries. We will give attention to conservation of materials. As you might know, a lot of materials can be damaged under the influence of light. This damage is visible in the form of discoloration, fading and ultimately disintegration of the objects. As you will see, the extent of damage caused by light radiation depends upon the sensitivity of the material, the illuminance level of the object or on the object, the exposure time of the light and the spectral composition of the light source. Let's first have a look to supermarkets. Damaging of objects due to light plays a role in many environments, for example in a supermarket. It is well known that especially sliced meat is very sensitive to discoloration. Here it is only a matter of hours before the red color fades away. Although this is a cosmetic problem, it still puts customers off. In total, the waste of food in supermarkets can cost more than 4% of the retailer's revenue. To extend shelf life for meat in order to reduce the waste, Philips recently introduced a special LED development called LED Rosé. This solution gives a 30% longer shelf life to meat under the same light intensity. Fashion. Another problem known from the retail branch is the discoloration of textiles in shelves or in shop windows. Also here, this problem is heard of less and less since more and more halogen lamps are replaced with more friendly LED lamps. Another reason for fewer complaints is the fast follow-up of fashion collections. In the past, the fashion industry did know only 4 collections per year. Today, new collections are brought to the market on a weekly basis. The result of that is that the display time of products is reduced from months to weeks or even days. This makes that the problems due to discoloration of lighting is not an issue anymore. But now let's have a look at museums. What happens in museums and galleries where products are displayed for many years? Here it is the intention that also new generations of visitors will be able to enjoy the art and objects on display in the centuries to come. It is for that reason that suggestions that in the future 3D printed copies will be displayed, so the originals can be stored in a dark, safe environment, are heard more and more. Sensitivity of materials. Starting point when designing lighting for museums are the objects on display. We know that some materials are more sensitive to photometrical damage than others. The degree of sensitivity depends upon the material's intrinsic capacity to absorb radiant energy and to be affected by it. Application research on this matter in the field of museum lighting has led to the classification of materials according to the degree of light sensitivity, so allowing recommended lighting levels to be arrived at. Especially organic materials like papers, inks, organic pigments and dyes, for example, are easily damaged by light or radiation in the shortwave region of the spectrum. The damage manifests itself in the form of decoloration, fading and ultimately disintegration. Organic materials like glass, ceramics, stone, inorganic pigments, minerals and metals are almost unaffected by light. To give an example, drawings on paper made with pencils are very sensitive for photometrical damage. When put in full sunshine, it is possible the drawing fades away in days. But petrified fossils, which are millions of years old, are not sensitive at all. They have been laying in the sun in the desert for millions of years already without being impacted. Here we see tables of the different product categories. For your information, the advised maximum general lighting level in museums and art galleries is 150 lux. The table indicates the maximum illumination level and lux hours per year on the objects. So 50,000 lux hours means that an object can be lighted with 50 lux for a period of 1,000 hours. When the lighting level is reduced to 25 lux, the same object can be lighted for 2,000 hours. What about daylight versus artificial light? Next to bringing out the objects aesthetically to their best, conservation of the objects is of key value in museums and galleries. Often, this is one of the reasons that daylight is not preferred. The light quantity is often less controlled and can be killing for the artifacts. Next to that, daylight is rich in UV, even after passing through window glass. The general tendency is therefore to make only limited use of daylight where conservation measures are in force. The advantage of artificial light is that we can control it completely. We can make a choice for the amount of light, and with LEDs now we have the option to go for spots which have a low infrared and UV content in the spectrum. New with LEDs is that in combination with presence sensors, it is possible to dim or switch off the light when there are no visitors around. In this way, the light load which can be expressed in lux hours can be limited to an absolute minimum. In general, damage to objects can be caused by human actions, for example vandalism, air pollution, humidity and light, which comes in the form of electromagnetic radiation. The characteristics of electromagnetic radiation depend on the wavelength. The visible part of the light spectrum lies between 380 and 780 nanometers. Beyond 780 nanometers, at longer wavelengths, the radiation is called infrared. This can be felt as heat. At the shorter wavelengths, below 380 nanometers, the radiation is called ultraviolet. This UV radiation is harmful to the eyes, causes skin tanning and also fading of colors due to the chemical processes which are caused by the absorption of this radiation. Okay, let's first talk about damage due to heat. Temperature changes on products are a real killer. The object will change from cold to warm all the time, and the mechanical stress due to this change in temperature can in the end damage the products. Next to mechanical stress, the heat radiation can also result in a change to the relative humidity around the lighted object, which can lead to degradation of moisture absorbing materials like paper, wood and leather. Radiant heating effects are mostly caused by the infrared radiation in the beam of the spot. In the past, this was not easy to solve. The best option was to use cool beam spots, special UV filters or fiber optics. Fiber optics does not radiate infrared, but it is inefficient and expensive. Now LEDs offer a perfect alternative, since they do not radiate heat in the beam. Still, one should be aware that LEDs also produce heat and that ventilation should be taken into account when one, for example, designs a closed showcase. The next subject we are going to talk about is damage due to photometrical stress. Light radiation itself can cause discoloration, fading and ultimately disintegration. Here we see a picture of two sets of test samples, each containing a number of textile specimens with pigments of different sensitivity. One set was illuminated by a particular light source for a certain period of time and at a certain lighting level. The other set remained in complete darkness. By comparing the two, the effects of fading on the different test samples can be easily noticed. Needless to say, the sample with the most sensitive pigments exhibits the greatest degree of fading. Let's now have a look at light sources and damage factor. The fading caused by one light source relative to another is called damage factor. This factor indicates the relative damage caused by that light source compared with other light sources, providing that the illumination level at the illumination and the illumination time are constant. The damage factors are listed for a number of light sources. Generally speaking, the value depends on the spectrum of the source concerned. In general, light sources of higher color temperature emit relatively more radiation in the blue region of the spectrum. The lower the factor, the less damage the light source is bringing about. LEDs score optimal. See the table which includes figures for both sunlight and artificial lighting. Well, what is fading risk? To compare the impact of different lighting situations with each other, the fading risk can be calculated. The fading risk compares one situation with another. For example, an indoor light situation can be compared with the damage as it can occur in full sunlight in a shop window behind 4 millimeters of glass. So fading risk is the damage caused by one light source relative to another, calculated for a certain lighting level and for a certain period of time. Fading risk is expressed as the product of four factors. First, we have a constant, which is called A. Then we have the damage factor for the light source. Then we have the illumination level. And last but not least, we have the exposure time in hours. So let's have an example at a shop situation. When we take a damage factor of 0.5 for daylight, through 4mm thick window glass with an illumination level of 10,000 lux and an exposure time of 1 hour. And we put the fading risk on 100. So now we can calculate the constant, which is in this case 0.02. So the formula is 100 is 0.02, that's a constant, we just found it, times 0.5, the damage factor, times 10,000, the illumination level in lux, times 1, which is the time in hours, 1 hour in this case. The constant 0.02 is needed to create a reference fading risk of 100. So the formula now is, the fading risk is 0.02 times the damage factor, times the illumination level, times the time. A fading risk of 100 is equivalent to the illumination in a shop window under bright summer sunshine for 1 hour. Compared to the shop window situation above, a lighting level of 500 lux from a tubular fluorescent lamp, which has a damage factor of 0.2, results in a fading risk of 0.02 times 0.2 times 500 times 1 hour, and then the fading risk is not higher than 2. So the fading risk of the pigments occur here 50 times more slowly than at a fading risk of 100. So let's now have a look at an example in a museum situation. When we illuminate an object with an incandescent lamp which has a damage factor of 0.15, with an illuminance level of 500 lux and an exposure time of 1 hour, we can put the fading risk on 100, and we can find that the constant which is needed is 1.33. This is needed to create a reference of 100. So the formula now is, the fading risk is 1.33 times the damage factor times the illumination level times the time. A fading risk of 100 is equivalent to an illumination of an object in a museum under 500 lux with an incandescent lamp for 1 hour. Compared to the incandescent museum situation above, a lighting level of 150 lux for a LED with an 830 characteristics and a damage factor of 0.04 results in a fading risk of 1.33 times 0.04, the damage factor, times 150 lux times 1 is 8. The fading risk of the pigments occur here 100 divided by 8 is 12.5 times more slowly than at a fading risk 100. So, what is the conclusion of this talk? In general, it is best now to use LED sources when lighting shops, museums and art galleries, since they have a relatively low damage factor. In general, never exceed the maximum allowed lux levels and hours when the objects are really sensitive to lighting. It is advised to apply lighting controls with presence detection to bring the lux hours to a minimum. I hope this talk learned you something about fading and that you can really apply it in your job. Goodbye.